morning's docket. That is case number 109292, State of Kansas v. Shelley.
Please the court, I'm Nancy Ogle, here on behalf of Charles E. Shelley, appellant, and I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
3 minutes is granted.
Just to briefly touch on the facts, not to go into great depth, I'm sure you're familiar with them or will be within the next hour because the following case is a companion. Mr. Shelley and his wife, Kara Perry, who is the appellant in the following case, were charged with two drug severity level two violations, distribution of drug precursor and possession of a drug precursor, and they entered pleas. The sentencing happened to be the same day as this court entered its decisions and State versus Snellings and State versus Adams, which found that the elements of possession of drug paraphernalia were the same as the elements in the charges against Mr. Shelley. That in those cases, particularly discussed in greater length in Snelling, that lowered the severity level to a level four. Mr. Shelley's controlling sentence is 56 months. His two counts were to serve consecutively, and they would have been 11-month sentences had the Snellings been applied.
That's assuming that Snellings would apply equally to distribution and a possession case, right?
Correct.
Okay. Then that's a question that hasn't been answered in this case so far, the merits.
Correct.
Okay.
Just background, the Court of Appeals specifically directed me on behalf of Mr. Shelley to only brief the Ortiz question, and so I have never had the opportunity to brief the merits of whether Snellings would apply in this case.
And given that, assuming that we agree with you on other issues, what remedy would you ask for today? Do you think it should be remanded for?
Well, remanding will then just not, well, drag this out. Of course, he would like the benefit of the 11-month, either the court can have brief the merits and address that, or remand it to the Court of Appeals for that purpose. What I'm asking, what I stated in the supplemental brief, is that I would ask the court, although it's an exceptional sort of procedure, is to follow the Court of Appeals decision in the published opinion that was attached to the brief in Glazier, where basically the same sort of facts were presented in a 1507. This case is an appeal of a criminal case that started out as a motion under 1507. In Glazier, they said, well, we have all the facts in front of us. Let's not drag this out. We're remanding it with instructions to resentence him using the Snellings in 11-month sentences, and that's what I would ask this court to do. That seems to serve judicial economy and, of course, would suit my client quite well. As I mentioned, this originally started as Mr. Shelley had discussed taking an appeal with his attorney. He didn't specifically say, you must file a notice of appeal for me. And time went by. Once Mr. Shelley was in prison, he learned about the holdings of the Snellings and Adams case, and then filed his pro se 60-1507. I think, although I wasn't involved at that time, it appears that the district court essentially treated that as a request for resentencing or to correct a legal sentence, because this is always preceded in the criminal case. We're not here on a 1507 appeal. And the court then, on his motion, appointed him counsel, brought him back for resentencing, agreed that the Snellings case applied to the possession of drug precursor, so changed that sentence to an 11-month sentence, but remained a 56 controlling because it didn't get resentenced on the distribution of a drug precursor. Then the appeal was taken, and once the appeal was docketed, a motion was filed to remand for an Ortiz hearing, because as you know, that unless this will fall under a direct appeal that can go back to the time that the appeal should have been filed, then Snellings and Adams won't apply. He won't get the benefit. The district court conducted that Ortiz hearing, and in this case, found that Mr. Shelley didn't meet any of the three exceptions that would allow an Ortiz, you know, going back so that he would get the benefit. And the focus was primarily on the third option of whether he had an attorney who failed to perfect the appeal. The first option was also argued and is still argued here, that he was not advised of his appeal. This, and I will quickly admit that the district court judge advised him of his right to appeal at his sentencing. And this argument is only based on the fact that the language in Patton, that is kind of a roadmap for Ortiz proceedings, specifically says that refers to advising the defendant of his right to appeal the severity level.
That happened to be the issue in Patton, right?
Pardon?
That happened to be the precise issue
right.
in Patton.
Right. Right. But for argument today, I'm going to focus on the third option of having an attorney who failed to perfect an appeal.
Can I back you up to that language in Patton and ask if you know of any support that would suggest outside of Patton that a district court has an obligation to do that?
I admit that I looked for other cases because I would love to be able to cite more cases for that, and I only found that language in Patton.
And also the statutes that are cited in Patton only refer to a broader
Correct.
Explanation of a right to appeal.
Right.
So if we read Patton in the context of its facts only, and that the court was talking about the issue directly before it, there's no support for your position beyond that.
Well, that's true, except that in this case, we also have the same issue that was presented in Patton of it's the severity level that's being questioned.
But actually a broader rule benefits most defendants, including your
Correct.
Court.
Yeah. For a standard of review under Ortiz, this court looks for substantial competent evidence, and then any legal determination based on that evidence is a de novo review. Just to go into, in order for the Ortiz discussion and whether Mr. Arnold was Shelley's retained counsel, and they discussed before and after sentencing the possibility of appeal. And it is clear from even the Ortiz hearing that Arnold was aware that that Mr. Shelley wanted to appeal, but his advice was that there was no purpose in appealing because he'd gotten a sentence within the grid, and you know, he was unaware, understandably, at that on that day, he wasn't aware of this court's decisions in Snelling and Adams since they came down the same day. But at the same time, other cases have said that, you know, merely looking at the annotations following a statute is not sufficient effort by the counsel in advising the defendant to whether he has a right, you know, a substantive reason to appeal other than a whim of I want to appeal because I can.
Do we know for sure when Mr. Arnold learned about Snelling?
He learned about it after the 14 days of filing a notice of appeal. As I said, Mr. Shelley learned of it like in June following his sentencing in April. And he wrote to Mr. Arnold right away saying, hey, what about these cases? Can't I get an appeal? Isn't there a reason? And Mr. Arnold basically said, you know, I'm the lawyer and you're not, and didn't proceed any further with his letter. I think Mr. Arnold looked at it as my representation is done because I was hired to represent you at trial level and you're past that now and now I'm serving your sentence. I'm running out of time. If you have any questions specifically that you would like me to answer.
Is it your contention that to be an effective assistance of counsel under the third exception, does that require defense attorneys to check the internet every Friday to determine what the case law is if there's to get into that 14-day window to appeal? This is a standard of practice case, it looks like to me, because you have to for the third exception, you have to have ineffective assistance of counsel to the extent that he didn't know he could, or that there were grounds. Certainly an attorney would say, you know, I've looked at the facts, we have a plea deal, we've got kind of what we bargained for, and then the law changes, which certainly it does on occasion. But what is it your contention that defense attorneys should be held to a standard that they check every Friday and then do that continuous checking as we go through? As long as the case has the right to appeal?
Well, I would say based on the a case or two that I cited that said, you know, knowing what the case annotations and printed documents are is not enough, that the attorney needs to be doing more. I did ask Mr. Arnold at the Ortiz hearing whether he checked every Friday, and I mean, as an attorney who does almost exclusively appeal work, I look every Friday, so it is done. And I would say maybe not, you know, the split second he got home on Friday or back to his office after that sentencing, but I would think he has a duty to check to see if the law has changed, and lots of attorneys I'm aware of, there's a association and we have a very active listserv and we are pretty much aware of what issues are in the pipeline. So I would say he had a duty to
take that one step further. What happens if you're going to the Bahamas on Thursday and the person is sentenced on Thursday? Does that mean you have to have somebody, you know, have signed that case to somebody else, because we always have this 14-day period after sentencing to file your appeal, and if the law changes and you're not available, is that ineffective assistance of counsel?
Well, I admit that's a tough question. I think lawyers should be able to go on vacation. But I think they have a duty to, like I say, knowing what's in the pipeline would give him, that person a clue, that attorney a clue as to whether a certain decision or type of case is going to come down.
Would you agree that if there's a lot of cases in the pipeline, probably
right.
cases including appeal of presumptive sentences, Apprendi issues, all those cases are always in the pipeline, wouldn't that argument mean that every criminal case has to be appealed? Or you'll be ineffective if the law changes in some future time?
Well, I think that would be taking it to the extreme. I would say a large part of the Ortiz hearing was not so much Mr. Arnold talking so much about, how quickly he kept up on the change in cases, but that he was hired to do their district court proceeding, and there had been no discussion about being paid for filing a notice of appeal. I think that points towards an ineffective assistance of the counsel if you can't take 30 minutes to file a notice of appeal. And it's really the client's decision to file a notice of appeal, and not the attorney's.
Now, under bid regulations, the trial counsel is required to file, that's their one of their last official acts, is to file a notice of appeal. So that is part of the trial representation. Do you think that general standard of practice should be included for all lawyers who are representing criminal defendants at trials?
Yeah, I think so. Because otherwise, either that, or if they don't want to have anything to do with it, they have the option of filing an immediate note in motion to withdraw and ask for appointment of counsel to then advise the defendant of whether to take an appeal.
Any further questions of counsel?
Well, just let me clarify something that Judge Fowler was inquiring about. So you're saying that Mr. Arnold was testified that he wasn't hired to take the appeal or to delve into those issues. If he had known about Snelling's, would that have made a difference? Did he say that if he'd known about Snelling's, he would have taken an appeal or at least filed the notice?
I don't think he made a statement like that, but I don't know that he was specifically asked that question.
Okay.
Any more questions? Thank you, counsel.
May it please the court, my name is Kevin Hill. I'm the county attorney for Brown County. I appear today on behalf of the state of Kansas. And initially, I'd point out that I think both parties would concede that the defendant's failure to file an appeal within 14 days of the sentence would prevent him from collaterally attacking his sentence and asserting relief under Snelling's. And that's why we're here, and that's why there was a request made for examination of whether one of the Ortiz exceptions apply. The defendant has not asserted the second Ortiz exception, and that is that they were not provided with an attorney to exercise the right to appeal. However, I do want to address something that was brought up by defense counsel, and that is that he was hired for the trial stage and there was no discussion of him doing anything on appeal. And I think the Ortiz hearing would not support that. I think he indicated that there were discussions, both defendants, including Mr. Shelley, were aware of the fact that if they did not hire Mr. Arnold to represent them, that they would have counsel appointed to them. These were, as I described in the brief, criminally savvy defendants. This was not their first time in court, not the first time they have been involved in an appeal. and had, I believe, court-appointed counsel before. So I did want to clarify that was discussed following the sentence, and both defendants were fully aware of the fact that the court would appoint counsel.
But as Judge Fowler said, if they had asked for appointed counsel, the appellate defender's office, my recollection is that the regulations were, or the rules were, that trial counsel does certain things before it goes to the appellate defender. I had to file a notice of appeal, I had to file a motion for a transcript, and do the papyrus affidavit, and do all of that thing to get the order of appointment of the appellate defender. So that, in that regard, that would fall on the trial counsel.
And that would be correct, and I think, as happened here, the court would have appointed local counsel to represent them on that stage, just as the court did on the 1507 motion that was filed. As far as the first Ortiz exception, I do want to address that just briefly, and that is, I mean, KSA 223424F, KSA 224505, only require the sentencing judge to advise the defendant of their right to appeal and the right to have appointed counsel. And as the Court of Appeals addressed in the decision in this case, there is not a requirement to advise a defendant of their right to appeal the severity level of the offense. I think defense is using the dicta of this court from Patton to try to fashion an additional requirement of trial courts that's not found in statutes, not supported in the statutes, and where you're unable to find any cases that would have imposed that burden. So we would urge the court to not address the first Ortiz exception, but we would urge the court to agree with our position that it would simply not apply. I think all parties agree that the district court did specifically advise the defendant of his right to appeal within 14 days of the sentence. And so that leaves us with the third Ortiz exception, and that is what the focus has been for the most part on remand with the district court. I think what's important to note here, and I think the Court of Appeals noted, the defendant did wait 87 days before they filed a 1507 motion, and in that 1507 motion, the defendant did not allege that his trial counsel was inadequate or ineffective in representing him, but merely alleged that they should have been sentenced under State versus Snellings. And as this court said in Patton, I think it's important to recognize what Ortiz did not do, and as this court indicated, it did not endow criminal defendants with any additional constitutional rights, it did not impose affirmative duties on counsel or the court, and it did not set up new requirements that must be met to prevent a late appeal. It was described as an exceptional remedy by the courts, and I think we need to focus on the fact that it is an exceptional remedy. I think what was attempted here is to bring an ineffective assistance of counsel claim through the Ortiz hearing and through the Ortiz exceptions, and I don't know that is something that Ortiz was set out to do. I think as this court addressed in Patton, and then I think the Flores-Ortega case, when the defense counsel is so deficient that it affects the actual filing an appeal, I think that's where the exception comes forward.
And why would that not apply here? You have a situation where there was at least a claim, may not have been a successful one, but at least a claim, and the client was told there's nothing to appeal. There's no basis for an appeal. So why wouldn't that be a deficiency? I mean, isn't some look at the standard of performance or lack of performance by counsel inherent in the third Ortiz exception? And didn't Patton recognize that?
Well, and one point as far as being told nothing to appeal, I think neither Mr. Shelley nor Mr. Arnold testified to that at the Ortiz hearing. I think that's something that has been alleged and has been stated in the brief on the co-defendant, but in reviewing the transcripts again last night, that was not indicated. What happened in that meeting is that they were upset initially that they had received probation despite the fact it was a presumptive prison case and despite the fact that they were on felony probation at the time, which would have allowed for a prison sentence. That was the focus of the discussion with Mr. Arnold. And Mr. Arnold, in the discussions with them, basically stated that you took a plea, you got the benefit of a reduced sentence and a reduced charge. I advise that the likelihood of success in that would be low, and that wouldn't be something I would want to do. So he did discuss the fact that they had the right to appeal. He did discuss with them his opinion at the time that the likelihood of success would be low and that they had received a concurrent sentence and the benefit of the bargain. But to address your question,
that's
as far
Arnold's
as...
Mr. Arnold's testimony. What was the defendant's testimony on that point?
On that point...
on what Mr. Arnold told him.
On Mr. Shelley, that they had discussed it, but in nowhere in his testimony did he say that he told him there was nothing to appeal. Basically, he acknowledged they had discussed the appeal. I would disagree that he was aware that Mr. Shelley wanted to appeal. It was merely an inquiry of an appeal, not a directive to appeal, which I think is mostly what the third Ortiz exception
addresses. There's any dispute on whether this rose to a directive versus an inquiry. I think your opposing counsel basically conceded that point. I'm just trying to focus on exactly what the defendant's testimony is. And regardless of the wording, the defendant did not testify in this case that he was told that there wasn't an issue for appeal or there was nothing worth appealing.
My recollection is that he did testify on cross that the discussions took place following sentence, and there was discussion of the cost that it would that they would incur, and that they were out of money. But he was very clear in saying he was aware of the fact that the court would have appointed counsel if he was unable to afford counsel.
And that's it. That's the extent of it.
I think there was more to that, but specifically, it was more than you have nothing to appeal. I think they did discuss.
Well, I understand that, but I'm just trying to get, was there a communication from counsel to the defendant that there was no issue for appeal?
I don't believe in those terms, no.
Okay.
Now, as far as I understand, the question was it inherent on the third exception? And I think in Ortiz, this court referred to Norris versus Wainwright and stated that it recognized that Norris specifically stated that neither the Sixth Amendment nor the 14th Amendment to the United States required the record to reflect that a defendant made a knowing and intelligent decision not to appeal before he or she can be precluded from appellate review. And I think that's a critical point here, in that Patton and the other cases dealt with situations where defense counsel, I think in Patton, said that he was going to file an appeal within the 14 days and just flat out failed to do so. And then in another case where I believe defense counsel misrepresented to his client that he had filed an appeal and didn't do so. And I think that can be distinguished between cases where, defense counsel may not have read the advance sheets, may not have read what was pending at the time. There is a remedy for that, and I don't think Mr. Shelley's without remedy. You can file a 1507, you can file a motion withdraw plea, but to have an extraordinary remedy, as mentioned in Ortiz, to allow a late filing of a direct appeal, I don't think is what Ortiz was set up to do under the facts of this case. And I believe I've hit on most of the points I had in my brief. If there are any questions?
Any questions of counsel? That concludes your presentation?
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, counsel. You reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
I just wanted to briefly address the question of what Mr. Shelley testified to at the Ortiz hearing. I have the transcript here, and on direct exam, Mr. Shelley stated that he'd ask after the hearing about a sentencing, and then quoting, "We were in the small courtroom and I asked him what are appeal options. He told me we took a plea bargain, we were sentenced in the grid box, you know, we didn't have, there was nothing to appeal. And then on cross-exam, Mr. Hill asked, but you never directed him to file that appeal. Would you agree with that? And Mr. Shelley said, no, because he told me we didn't have anything to appeal. That's the highlights on for purposes of today. I would just ask that the court reverse the Court of Appeals. I would argue that Mr. Shelley meets the third option, at least under Ortiz. Mr. Hill made quite a discussion about the fact that Ortiz is an exceptional remedy, which I would agree with, but it's still there. It's supposed to be used when the facts are correct. And I think the facts are correct in this situation. I would ask that Mr. Shelley be given the benefit of the Snellings and Adams cases. And as I discussed when I was up here earlier, that I realize I have not had the opportunity to brief the merits, but I think the court has sufficient facts between this case and Kara Perry's case that follows. I would ask that this court remand to the district court for resentencing. Anything?
Any further questions?
Just a moment. This is unusual, but I'd like to give your opponent an opportunity to correct his statement to the court about what's in the transcript. Have you now found where he said there's nothing to appeal? Could you answer, please?
Could you stand up to the lectern, because we're streaming live on the internet and want people to
hear? Yes, I have reviewed the on the direct, and it was following the statements where we had taken the plea agreement, we were sentenced in the grid box, but he did conclude with, we know we didn't, there was nothing to appeal, so I did notice that.
Okay, that's one place, and the second place was on cross-examination that your opposing counsel pointed out. Do you have a page for that, Ms. Ogle?
Yes. Page 17.
Thank you.
Yes, I do see on page 18 where he did indicate that, but you never directed him to file that appeal. No, because he told me we didn't have anything to appeal.
Thank you.
Any further questions of either counsel, since we're branching into new territory here? I see none. Thank you both for your arguments this morning. Court will take this matter under advisement.